I'll let you do it.
All right. So should I start now?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. So maybe so let me introduce the speaker. Today's speaker is Allan Sly from Princeton University. And he had his PhD degree in UC Berkeley at 2009. And then he went to Microsoft Research, and then he back to Berkeley, and in 2016 he came to Princeton, and until now. So Professor Sly has did lots of fundamental work, and in many areas like probability theory, the phase transitions, and the satisfiability problems. And so I will not go into detail of his work, and I invite you to listen to his talk today. I just want to make, among the many prizes he received, I just want to mention one prize he received in the 2018 MacArthur Fellows. And in the prize cited that he applying probability theory to resolve long-standing problems in statistical physics and computer science. So let's welcome Professor Sly. Thank you.
Oh, well, thanks so much. And thanks so much for the invitation to speak here. So I'm going to be talking about sort of new work in random constraint satisfaction problems. So I know Nike Sung gave a talk here a few years ago about that. And I spoke here in the current developments in mathematics lectures a few years ago. So there'll be, since I'm trying to give a general talk, there'll be sort of overlap with those. So apologies for that. But for the experts, there'll be sort of the newest results you have to wait until the end for. And so, you know, maybe you want to go and make a cup of tea now. So with that said, let me tell you what constraint satisfaction problems are. It's a term that comes from combinatorics and theoretical computer science, and it basically means exactly what it sounds like. You have some variables, and you want them to satisfy a collection of constraints. So imagine satisfying a system of equations, or coloring a graph, or satisfying a Boolean formula. And so these play an important role in sort of complexity theory, computational complexity theory. But coming from probability theory, I'll be interested in random constraint satisfaction problems where the constraints are chosen randomly according to some rule. So to just fix a sort of nice example of what a random constraint satisfaction problem could be, imagine take your sort of favorite model of a sparse random graph. Maybe it's an Erdős-Rényi random graph where you have n vertices, and you connect each pair of vertices with an edge independently with probability p. And I'll be interested in the sparse case, so we'll let p scale as a constant over n, so the average degree remains constant. Or a random deregular graph where you take all of the a uniformly chosen deregular graph over n labeled vertices. And then you ask, is there a proper coloring, a proper K coloring of this graph? And so here the colors of the vertices are the variables, and the edges are the constraints. And since saying that neighboring vertices have to have different colors. And since the edges were chosen randomly, it's a random constraint satisfaction problem. Another sort of combinatorial example would be asking, are there large independent sets in the random graph? Okay, so another place where random CSPs come from are random Boolean formulas. And the canonical example of this is the random KSAT model. So you have n Boolean variables taking values either true or false. And for the rest of the talk, I'm going to write just plus or minus. And then the constraints are formed by taking the OR of k of the variables or their negations. So something like a clause will be something like x3 or x4 or not x5. And then we want, and we choose these constraints uniformly from the 2n choose k possible clauses. And then we take a bunch of independent constraints and we want them all to be satisfied. So we take the AND of those. And that gives you a random Boolean formula. And a solution to this is just an assignment of the variables so that the formula evaluates to true. And I'll call these either solutions or sometimes satisfying assignments. And so of course, the more constraints you have, the fewer solutions you'll have, the harder it will be to satisfy all the constraints at once. So we can parameterize the difficulty by the ratio of the number of constraints divided by the number of variables. And I'll call this alpha during the talk. And we'll be interested in sort of how the space of solutions changes as alpha increases. And I also want to mention a variant of the random KSAT model, which is the one that we have new results for. So it's called not all equals SAT, and it's a KSAT formula, but you ask that both X and the negation of X evaluates to true. Or equivalently, in each clause, at least one term evaluates to true, and at least one term evaluates to false, and sort of hence the name not all equal. So it has many of the same sort of qualitative properties and phase transitions we expect to see in random KSAT, but it has some extra symmetries. For instance, if you take a random solution, each variable is equally likely to be true or false, just because you can, if X is a solution, then not X is also a solution. And to make things even more homogeneous, we'll look at the regular version of not all equals SAT, where we ask that every variable is in the same number of clauses. And so this is kind of the analog of looking at a random regular graph rather than the Erdős-Rényi random graph. Okay, and so let me say a little bit about sort of the graphical view of these models. So each of these constraint satisfaction problems we can think of as happening on a certain graph. For the combinatorial properties of random graphs, it's obvious what the graph is there. But for the Boolean formulas, we can take our random Boolean formula and construct what's called a bipartite factor graph, where on one side of the graph, we have one vertex for each of the variables. And on the other side, we have one vertex for each of the clauses, and we just connect a variable to a clause if the variable appears in the clause. Okay. And because we chose the clauses at random, this is a random graph. And like, I guess, most models of random graphs, it's locally tree-like in the sense that if I pick a random vertex in the graph and look at its local neighborhood, what you'll see there is a tree. There are very few short cycles in these graphs. There are lots of long cycles of length about log n, but the number of sort of short cycles of length, say four, will be just order one, independent of n the number of variables. So a typical vertex doesn't see any nearby short cycles. And it's really this locally tree-like structure that makes it possible to exactly calculate thresholds in these models. And the reason for that is essentially if the local neighborhood was a tree, if you look at a random solution on when the graph is a tree, if I fix the value at the root, then what's happening in its subtrees becomes conditionally independent. And this conditional independence that sort of happens in principle in the limit makes a lot of calculations possible. Okay, so what do we want to say about these models? Well, question number one is just, when are there solutions? So for what alpha, what range of values of alpha are there solutions? What is the satisfiability threshold? But once you've answered this, there are a whole range of additional questions you can ask. How many solutions are there? What does a randomly chosen solution look like? If I take two solutions chosen at random, what does their joint distribution look like? How far away are they from each other? And then algorithmically, you could ask the question of just, can you find one of these solutions in a sort of computationally efficient way, or sort of faster than just brute force? And the story I want to tell you is about how ideas coming from theoretical physics, the study of disordered systems such as spin glasses, has sort of led to a whole host of predictions about of different phase transitions for these models. The physicists who've worked on these problems, they don't usually write proofs. They can, but most of their theory is just theory in the sense of theoretical physics, which as a mathematician means that there's just a whole host of conjectures to try and prove. And that's as well as, but on top of that, also a sort of rich insight that they've provided. And so in the course of the talk, I want to also tell you about what, a couple of different terms that you'll hear in this theory. So I should say, all of the models I've told you about lie in what the physicists would call the one-step replica symmetry breaking universality class. So meaning that they all behave in roughly the same way. And so over the course of the talk, I want to sort of also say what some of these terms you might hear, replica symmetry breaking, which sort of says something about the way in which solutions break into clusters, and also the cavity method, which is a heuristic they developed for calculating various quantities in these models. Okay, so before I get too far into that, I just want to do a very simple calculation, which is just to calculate the expected number of solutions of one of these random CSPs. And let's do this for the noddle equal SAT, the regular noddle equal SAT model. So there's 2 to the n possible ways of assigning all the variables. And then each clause is satisfied with probability 1 - 2 - -k - 1. And they're all independent of each other, because essentially the way in which you set variables to be either negated or not is independent in each clause. So you can just write down exactly the expected value. And it's like e to the power of n times some exponent. And so you could look at, okay, what's the point, for what value of alpha does this exponent become zero? And so that will mark sort of the threshold where you go from the expected value tending to infinity versus tending to zero. And so that this at least gives you an upper bound on the satisfiability threshold by Markov's inequality. But it's not the right threshold. And the reason for this is that, at least in a typical solution, there'll be a constant fraction of the variables which are sort of unconstrained. So in the sense that if I flip them from true to false or false to true, that wouldn't violate any of the constraints that they're in. So, and in a typical solution, you can find epsilon n unconstrained variables that don't share any clauses in common. And so these can be flipped in 2 to the epsilon n different ways. So essentially, if you have one solution, you always have at least 2 to the epsilon n solutions. And if you plug that into Markov's inequality, you get a slightly better bound on the threshold, which is still not the right one, but it sort of illustrates one important point, which is that when you have solutions, you have a lot of nearby solutions too, or put another way, solutions come in clusters. And understanding the way in which they split into clusters is really at the heart of the story that I want to describe. Now, if you want a lower bound showing when you do have solutions, the most natural thing is to try is the second moment method. And So this works and or gives useful bounds when the second moment of the number of solutions, z, is of the same order as the first moment squared. And for the not equal SAT model, also for colorings of random graphs, this works quite well. It doesn't get to the right threshold, but it gets fairly close. So in the case of, say, not equal SAT, the threshold for where you find solutions is about 2 to the k minus 1 times log 2. And the upper bound you get from the first moment and the lower bound you get from the second moment just differ by a small constant. So the threshold is growing like 2 to the k minus 1, and the gap between the bounds is just like something like 1 or so. So already these do quite well. But there's always a gap. And the reason for the gap is, essentially the way in which the relative sizes of the clusters, and that's something that, that's going to be the main content of this talk. So I'll tell you more about that. But essentially, what goes wrong with the second moment method is that when we get close to the satisfiability threshold, the typical number of solutions, the expected number of solutions is much bigger than the typical number. There's a transition point where that happens, and then the second moment method fails at that point. Okay, so let me give you the sort of non-rigorous physics story. Non-rigorous isn't a nice word. I mean, they have sort of very deep understanding of the models, but it's not with proofs. The ideas that they sort of originated in work of Mezard and Parisi in sort of the 80s, but reached their final form in sort of about 13 or 14 years ago in work of Krajakula, Montanari, Rishi Tersengi, Semijan, and Zed Radova. And if you've seen these talks before by me or Nike or other collaborators or other people working in this field, you will have seen this sort of ink blot-like picture before. And so let me just explain what this is supposed to represent. It's supposed to represent the way in which solutions come in clusters. So what does a cluster of solutions mean? Well, you can think of two solutions as being adjacent if they differ in one variable or maybe a small number of variables. And so if you have a notion of two solutions being adjacent, then you can start to talk about connected components of solutions. And these are what these clusters are. And going from left to right is what happens as we increase the constraint density. So when the density of constraints is low, all or almost all of the solutions are in one giant cluster. But at a certain threshold, they split into exponentially many small clusters, each with just an exponentially small fraction of the solutions, and almost all of them well separated from each other. You have to move a long way to go from one cluster to another. This point seems to be the point at which the algorithms people know stop working well, fail. So below this clustering threshold, in all of the problems I've told you, there are sort of computationally efficient ways of finding solutions to the CSP. If you go a bit above the threshold, then all of the algorithms people have don't seem to find thresholds and or solutions. Sorry, and so certainly local search type algorithms are going to struggle in a very sort of clustered if the solution space is very clustered, particularly because there's also a lot of While there's lots of clusters of solutions, there's also lots of clusters of almost but not quite solutions that sort of some sort of local, so lots of local minima that a search algorithm could get trapped in. But both this well-connected and the clustered regime are still both in what physicists would call the replica symmetric regime. And what this means, and so replicas means sort of choosing a random solution. And so if you draw several replicas, you're just choosing several random solutions from the same problem. And and so in this replica symmetric regime, when you take two random solutions, they'll look basically orthogonal to each other. They'll look like sort of two, if you think of them as strings of trues and falses, they'll look basically like two independent strings. But then the next transition is, which happens much closer to the satisfiability threshold, is the condensation transition. After this point, you still get solutions coming in clusters, but now the biggest few clusters dominate. A more refined version of the prediction is that if you look at the relative cluster sizes, they obey what's called a Poisson-Dirichlet distribution. And now if you pick two solutions at random, well, two things can happen. Either you pick them, say, both in the same cluster, and then they'll be quite close together, or you pick them two solutions in different clusters, and then they'll be again sort of almost orthogonal to each other. And so replica symmetry breaking is sort of this property of when you look at the overlap, which is like the normalized inner product between them, then this is concentrated now on two points. And that roughly corresponds to solutions being either in the same cluster or in different clusters. The final threshold is the satisfiability threshold. And then after that, there's no more solutions. So each of the CSPs that I've told you about all lie in this one-step replica symmetry breaking class. And it's because essentially there's only one level of clustering. So when you look at inner products between replicas, there's only sort of two possible values you can get. There are other models like sort of a dense random sort of model like what's called the Sherrington-Kirkpatrick model, where you get a more complicated type of clustering. You get the space breaks up into clusters of clusters and clusters of clusters of clusters, and there's a sort of infinite hierarchy of level of clustering. Here, there's really only one level of clustering. Okay, so how can, one thing I wanted to say. All of this I've described so far sounds pretty hand-wavy, but there are sort of, the physicists have like quantitative predictions for where each of these thresholds occur and sort of what the clusters look like in each of these regimes and many of the other questions you might ask. So you might say, well, you know, your definition of a cluster doesn't sound very tractable. How can you say anything useful about that? Well, there's another better representation of a cluster in terms of what I'll call the frozen model. And we can arrive at that by, let's say, take one solution to our CSP. So assign pluses and minuses, i.e. trues and falses to each of the variables. Some of these variables will be unconstrained or free. So we could flip them between plus or minus without violating any constraints. And if that's the case, I'll call it a free variable and set that variable to free. Now, setting one variable to free might then set a neighboring variable to free as well. So we sort of iterate this process. And then when we're done, Every variable is labeled either plus, minus, or free. And what you can show is that when you take a cluster of solutions, all of the solutions in that cluster get mapped to the same assignment of plus, minus, or free. So it sort of has the, this is mapping a whole cluster of solutions to just one point. And so it's a sort of efficient representation for the cluster of solutions. And the interpretation is the variables marked with a plus are always plus in that cluster. The ones marked with a minus are always minus in that cluster, and the free ones are the ones that you can switch between plus and minus. And this new plus minus free configurations is itself a random constraint satisfaction problem with a different set of rules. So free variables can't be forced by any clusters. Otherwise, we wouldn't have set them to be free. The plus and the minus variables must be forced by at least one cluster. Otherwise, we would have set them to be free. And if, and finally, no clauses can be violated. So this is a new, more complicated random constraint satisfaction problem, which I'll call the frozen model. But why do we want to study a more complicated one? Well, because we've removed the element of clustering from it. The clusters have just been mapped to single points. And so in the, so you'd also say that in this, that it's replica symmetric for the entire range of parameters. So this, the frozen model doesn't have replica symmetry breaking. So it's easier to deal with. And so the reason why you don't see clustering in this model is if sort of locally around a point, the graph you see will be tree-like. And if you define the frozen model, a frozen model configuration on an infinite tree, it has a sort of rigidity property, which is that to get to another frozen, valid frozen model configuration, you would have to change infinitely many of the variables to go from one valid configuration to another. What that sort of manifests in when looking at this in these sort of on the finite graph is that you typically have to change a linear number of variables to get from one valid configuration to another. And I'll let omega n be the number of clusters or the partition function of this, this frozen model. And so then another idea coming from physics is what's called the cavity method. And this is kind of a heuristic for saying, what if we added one extra variable to the model? So go from a graph of size n to a graph of size n plus one. So imagine we understood what a random solution looked like on a graph of size n, and then we add in one extra variable. So if we knew the joint distribution correctly on all these green variables, that will be the neighbor of the new variable, then we could essentially just using Bayes' rule, calculate the marginal distribution at the new variable, as well as the change in the number of solutions, sort of the multiplicative change in the partition function, which would be good because then we could write log of the partition function as sum of a sort of telescope, as a telescoping sum of logs of these ratios, and hopefully estimate the exponential growth rate of the number of solutions like that. And so when the model is replica symmetric, before we add in a new variable, the joint distribution of the green variables, which are effectively randomly chosen in the graph, will be independent and with marginal distribution drawn from some law mu. But this is no longer the case in the replica symmetry breaking setting. It's sort of true if you restrict the measure to individual clusters, but then you're taking a mixture of them, and mixtures of product measures are not product measures anymore. But But if we look at the frozen model, that's replica symmetric for the full range of parameters. So we can apply the cavity method in that setting. Now there's one thing left, which is it also depends on what the marginal law of these variables are. What is mu? Well, so what the physicists would say is that, well, we add in one extra variable. Now, a system of size n plus one should be like a system of size n. So this new variable should be like all the others, really. And so its marginal should also be drawn from the law mu, which means that mu must satisfy a certain fixed point equation. And so the procedure is you solve for mu by solving some fixed point equation, and then you work out the sort of multiplicative change in the number of solutions. So just to give you a concrete example of this in the case of random not equal set, here the the fixed point is simple. It's just a fixed point of just regular functions rather than a fixed point of a measure valued recursion. So you just solve this equation for Q, then plug it into into this fixed, then plug it into this functional, which is giving you the sort of expected change of log of the number of clusters as you increase the size of the graph by one. And then the prediction for where the satisfiability threshold is just you solve for the root of phi here. And so that marks the point where you go from the number of clusters growing exponentially to tending to zero exponentially. And so in the case of not equal set, this is now sort of a few years old, and now we're trying to establish more properties about it in the regime where we know there are solutions. And so that's the next part of the story. What can we say sort of beyond just calculating the satisfiability threshold? And to do this, I want to do sort of a heuristic calculation of the expected number of solutions. And so let's imagine that we sort of break up the expected value by summing over the clusters and sort of grouping them according to the size of the clusters. So, and we'll sort of make the leap of faith, I guess, that the number of clusters of size e to the ns should be given by e to the n times sigma of s for some function sometimes called the complexity function sigma. So just sort of assume for the moment that that actually exists. Then we could say, okay, well, where does the biggest contribution to this sum come from? Well, you would just want to maximize s plus sigma of s. And because everything's on the exponential scale, that would be the dominant contribution to the expected value. So equivalently, that's just like working out the point where the derivative of sigma is minus one. And this is what the picture should look like in the clustered regime. As we increase alpha and the density of constraints, we get fewer solutions. So sigma will decrease, and the condensation threshold corresponds to the point where this tangent line or the tangent point lies on the x-axis. In the condensation regime, it's strictly below. The satisfiability threshold, the maximum lies on the x-axis. And then in the unsatisfiable regime, sigma is negative for all values and there's no solutions. And now let me just comment on what's happening in the condensation regime. So the biggest contribution to the expected value is coming from cluster sizes that have a negative value of sigma, which means they're exponentially unlikely to appear. So as a result, the typical number of solutions is much smaller than the expected number of solutions. So what should the typical number of solutions be? Well, one guess would be it's the largest cluster size that does appear. So the largest value of sigma that's, the largest root of sigma. But at this point, sigma is zero, of course. So the number of clusters making the dominant contribution will be e to the zero. And that's where the prediction that most of the mass is just on a constant number of the clusters comes from. Now, if you make, now there's a more refined prediction, which is if you take an even bigger leap of faith and say sigma is not just telling you something about the expected number of clusters, but it's encoding some Poisson density of clusters, then that would lead you to a prediction that you'd see a Poisson-Dirichlet distribution of relative cluster sizes. Okay, so just to summarize, from this heuristic calculation, we could read off the satisfiability threshold, the condensation threshold, and also the free energy in the condensation regime, sort of the exponential growth rate of the number of solutions there. But this was all presupposing that A, sigma exists, and B, us knowing what the value of it is. So so we have to be able to find that quantity too. But let me just say that these predictions have now been verified in a number of different models. So in terms of the satisfiability threshold, there's been work in like a whole range of different models. The condensation threshold has been established by Kodrioglan's group for random colorings of random graphs, and then also for the condensation threshold for the regular not equal SAT model. And the one model in which we've been able to work out the sort of free energy for the inside the condensation regime is the regular not equal SAT model. And you can see that all of these come with sort of provisos that like K is large or the degree D is large. And essentially the problems when you let the degree of the graph grow, lots of quantities are just more concentrated and sort of easier to deal with. But so there's really a limit at this point where we don't know how to, let's say, prove things for 3 SAT or 3 not equal SAT, only when K is sufficiently large. Okay, so let me tell you about how we can sort of get our hands on the value of sigma, this complexity function. Well, working out the expected value of Z was like maximizing S plus sigma of S, or the point at which the derivative was -1. If we looked at the expected number of clusters, this would correspond to maximizing sigma, or maximizing 0 times S plus sigma of S, which, you know, corresponds to finding the point where the derivative of sigma is 0. But now we're interested in this tangent point where the derivative is minus lambda for some lambda between 0 and 1. And so the way we can access the value there is by constructing a new variable Z lambda, which corresponds to summing over all the clusters of their size to the power of lambda. And then the maximum contribution will come from the cluster size that maximizes lambda S plus sigma of S. Okay. And if we could do this, if we could work out the expected value of Z lambda for each choice of lambda, then take 1 over n log of that, we'd basically be computing the Legendre transform of sigma of S. And there's sort of reasons to believe sigma should be concave, so you would get back sigma of S if you did that. And then and then from that be able to work out what all the right thresholds were. But initially, this doesn't look like a very kind of tractable thing to try and do, because we're sort of splitting the solutions up into clusters, raising them to some non-integer power, and then trying to add them all up. But the reason why it can work is that we can think of Z lambda as being the partition function for the frozen model, where we add some extra weights to the free variables, and then can compute that combinatorially. So let me say a little bit about that. So if I give you a solution of the frozen model, that corresponds to a cluster, and if I ask, how would you work out the number of solutions in that cluster? Well, that's the number of ways of the sort of number of valid assignments of the free variables. Now, it turns out most of the free variables are just sort of isolated from each other. So they can be set two ways sort of independently of each other. But some of them come in groups with dependencies between them. But the groups are sort of are trees, and they're very subcritical branching processes. So they're very small trees. So essentially the total number of solutions in the cluster you get by just calculating the number of solutions in each of these trees and multiplying together by all of the trees that you have. So actually think of a sort of equivalent model where the free variables also get to know what sort of tree of free variables they live within. And then we use a sort of statistical procedure called belief propagation, which gives a way of calculating the number of solutions if your graph is a tree. And we essentially just use that to construct a set of weights on variables and clauses and edges, such that if you multiply all of them together within one of these trees, you get the number of ways of assigning the free variables within the tree. And if you multiply them to all of them together in the whole graph, you get the size of the cluster. And now if we want weights that give us the size of the cluster to the power of lambda, we just take these weights to the power of lambda and multiply them all together. So that gives us a new spin system with whose partition function is this quantity that we're trying to calculate. And so then the final step is calculating that partition function. And then this becomes more or less combinatorial. So we want a sum over pairs of graphs and configurations with these weights. It turns out that you want a first condition on sort of the empirical distribution of the solution, which is sort of like how many pluses you have, how many minuses you have, how many free variables you have of each type, and how many of those are next to each other. So I'll call that nu. And if you condition on nu, then this expected value becomes essentially just a product of weights times a product of multinomial coefficients. Now, if all of the trees of free variables were of a bounded size, then there'd just be sort of a bounded number of values each variable can take. And then we could take this formula, apply Stirling's formula a bunch of times, and you'd get e to the n times some function of the empirical distribution. And this tells you sort of the exponential growth rate of this Z lambda if you then maximize over empirical distributions nu. Now this function phi is sort of living in some fairly high dimensional space, and it's also not convex, but its fixed points can be found as solutions of certain belief propagation equations. So you can sort of describe what its fixed points look like, and show that the one that you thought should be the fixed point is gives the maximal contribution, and then work out this expected value. And so with Nike Sun and Yu Meng Zhang, we carried this out and worked out the exponential growth rate of the number of solutions for this regular nodal equal Saturn model. One of the steps in that was sort of truncating the size of trees of free variables. This was to give a lower bound on the number of solutions. Actually, there's an easier way to get an upper bound using a technique called the interpolation method, which I won't go into. But our lower bounds are sort of off by a factor of e to the little o of n. So this is enough to correctly identify the growth rate of the number of solutions, but it doesn't, it's not a fine enough analysis to tell us things about what's going on in the condensation regime in terms of are the solutions split into just a constant number of clusters. And so in the most recent work, with my student Danny Nam and Yong-Tak Sun, who's a student at Stanford, we got estimates of the partition function that are correct up to an order one factor. And by essentially evaluating this expected value more or less exactly. And so the challenge is now the free, you can't restrict the space of free variables that you look at. They come in sort of arbitrarily big trees. The biggest will be of size order log n. And one has to come up with a system of doing the calculation where you can deal with sort of essentially unbounded state spaces. And roughly speaking, the way we do that is take the graph, cut out all the parts that have big trees of free variables. So then we have sort of a graph with a boundary, and then have a way of sort of summing over all of the ways we can attach large trees of free variables to the boundary. And so in doing so, we can establish sort of for the first time in one of these random constraint satisfaction problems, or the sparse ones at least, that sort of the largest clusters each have a constant fraction of the total number of solutions. And so in particular, you have this replica symmetry breaking property where if you choose two solutions at random, there's some probability that they'll be in the same cluster, that's like a probability that's bounded away from zero, in which case the Hamming distance will be like a small constant times n. And there's also a positive probability that they'll be in different clusters, and then their Hamming distance will be about n over 2. Our methods weren't sort of able to get the more refined prediction that the relative cluster sizes are Poisson Dirichlet. So that's certainly something we're very interested in trying to establish. Thanks for listening.
I have some questions, but maybe first from the audience, any questions? So anyone has question about the talk about the result and so on? So I have a question. I don't understand. Do I understand it correctly that this random case problem has only one replica symmetry breaking solutions, and there's no infinitely many cluster?
So there's that's right. So the space of solutions splits into clusters, but there's no further structure beyond that. The clusters really look like a product measure, and actually they're It's because like within the cluster, it's essentially you know, you have these free variables, they come in sort of either singletons or small isolated trees, and then the way solutions are assigned within those is independent. So it's sort of, these clusters sort of look in some generalized sense like sort of hypercubes sitting inside the bigger hypercube of possible solutions. On the other hand, you can, there's a conjecture that you should be able to, so if you took, say, KSAT with, let's say, a mixture of clauses, some of size K and some of size K prime, that if you, at least if you choose the right K and K prime, then you, you'll get two levels of clustering.
So if you make K smaller, do you expect that for smaller K? I mean, just this is just purely just.
No, so so for KSAT and for, say, not all equal SAT, all of the predictions should hold true even down to K equals 3.
Really?
K equals 2 is a bit different, but so on the other hand, if you look at large independent sets in random graphs, there, I think it's supposed to be one RSB down to, but whenever the let's say deregular random graphs, whenever D is greater than or equal to 20, but full replica symmetry breaking for D 19 and below.
Really?
And there's just there's sort of a stability calculation you can do that sort of holds for D greater than or equal to 20 and doesn't hold for smaller values of D.
All right. So of course I'm very curious about this, but I don't want to take up everybody's time. Are there some other questions?
I have a general question just about the vocabulary of the three regimes. Clustered, condensed, and non-existent, I guess. Do you envision other sort of finer partitions, finer regimes within them? I heard a hint of that in your response to HT's.
Right. Well, I guess in my response to HT, it was more sort of changing the underlying a different parameter of the model, like the K in KSAT or the average degree of the regular graph. There are a few other things that go on. So at the clustering threshold, there's sort of two transitions that happen around that point, almost at exactly the same point, but at a slightly different point. So one is it breaks into clusters. Another, but just above the clustering threshold, those clusters are supposed to be unfrozen in the sense that none of the variables are forced to be always plus or always minus in the cluster. And then you just go a little bit further and then it becomes frozen, and most of the variables are either always plus in the cluster or always minus in the cluster. And this is interesting from the computational point of view, because it's still not 100% clear whether or not the clustering transition is what makes it hard to find solutions or the freezing transition. But it's hard to even show that those are two separate transitions. And I've worked on that in the context of colorings on random graphs. And so you can work out the sort of prediction for where these thresholds come from by analyzing certain recursions of colorings on trees. And it's only in the sort of third order asymptotic term that these differ. So it's kind of a fine, this is a very fine delineation of different transitions. And, so we know that there's a regime where we have so the analogous problem on the tree is you have you look at the sort of random measures over colorings on the trees, and you can ask, are these measures frozen or not? And so there's a point where it sort of the sort of symmetric free measure on trees splits into is not extremal, so it's a convex combination of pure Gibbs states, which should correspond to the same threshold as when the graph splits up into clusters of solutions. And that's separate from the threshold for where the a random sort of coloring of the tree becomes frozen. And there are a few other points like that that have other points of transition that people study.
Thanks.
Are there some other questions about it?
Sure. One thing I'd love to hear about is just a few words about the belief propagation that you mentioned. I don't know that theory.
Essentially, suppose you were doing this on a tree and you wanted to work out the number of solutions on a tree, or say the probability that the root was of the tree was a plus. There's a way of doing sort of like dynamic programming, working from the leaves up to the root. And essentially it's sort of starting with the leaves, and then you add in their parent and sort of add in more parents, and you progressively work up to the root. And essentially you're just doing a Bayes rule computation at each level to compute marginal distributions. And so you can compute all the marginal distributions of a Gibbs measure on the tree in sort of linear time. And so it's belief propagation's a message passing algorithm. And basically it corresponds to one variable telling sort of its neighbor, this is what I think my marginal probability should be given everything on the other side of me. And all the variables pass their messages along, and you can and from out of these messages you can compute the weights that if you multiply them all together you get the total number of solutions on the tree.
I see.
This is something that came from people who do algorithms and actually like wanted to compute things like marginal probabilities, and it's also closely related to how physicists came up with their like theories of
So are there some other questions?
We have a question in the chat. I'm sorry.
Go ahead. So
the question in the chat might actually be me. I wrote three variables where you can change the value of one variable and stay in the solution. And I assume the contribution from changing two variables at once, but neither separately, is negligible.
So there are, I sort of swept a few details under the rug a little bit in what I said. There are apart from these three variables, if you want to change, so outside of the free variables, if you want to change the solution, you have to change sort of multiple variables at a time. And in particular, the variables you have to change has to include a cycle. And so in these graphs, they're locally tree-like, there aren't many cycles in the graph, or small cycles, I should say. But there are occasionally, you find a small number of four cycles. And so it is possible that you get, you have like a four cycle of solutions and where you can change them from say, switch round between, yeah. So you can make small changes on the very rare small cycles. The contribution of these is almost negligible, although actually we spent a surprisingly large amount of time sort of showing that they were negligible in this latest work. But negligible enough from the point of view of developing the theory, but not negligible from the point of view of writing the paper.
Thank you.
Some other questions?
You mentioned these, that there were two different thresholds that might actually be where the computability problem becomes hard, and you weren't even sure, it wasn't easy to determine if they were the same, those two were the same. Is that something where the physicists have some understanding like of whether they're supposed to be different or not, or you don't even know whether to conjecture if those two thresholds are the same or not?
I think the physicists would tell you that they're different. For the coloring model, at least the tree version of the problem, we know that they're different. And those are supposed to correspond to what happens in the random CSP as well. The physicists sort of calculate asymptotics for these different thresholds, but you have to go to sort of the third order term in the expansion to see mm-hmm. that they're different. When K is big at least. And then some weird things can happen when K equals 3. So when K equals 3, this freezing threshold, the gap is not very small. And actually the freezing threshold happens after the condensation threshold, or at least that's the prediction. We haven't proved anything about the 3-sat version of it. And that sort of led to a certain amount of confusion, because for a while physicists claimed that a certain algorithm called, I say physicists like it's one homogeneous group. I mean, one group of physicists claimed that an algorithm called survey propagation would work sort of beyond both of these thresholds sort of for most of the range of parameters. And I think that's no longer believed. Well, that's now, if you ask people, that's no longer believed to be the case. And I think part of the confusion of that was sort of around what's happening with 3-sat, where there's a much bigger gap between these two thresholds. Maybe the, you know, also N wasn't quite large enough in the simulations to.
All right, so I think maybe we are a bit over time, and so let's thank the speakers. And so let's thanks very much for Professor Sly to give his wonderful talk. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
Thank you.
So bye-bye, everybody.
And so I'll see you at 5.
Yes.
All right. Bye.
Thank you, Allan.